First of all, I want to thank our colleagues at IFPRI and all of the organizers who gave us this opportunity to share this particular initiative. Our CEO was blown yesterday away by the turnout and the crowd that she's not familiar with. She comes from a finance background, having worked in the World Bank for many years and in the Ministry of Finance in Japan. So she was really inspired by the presentations that were made in the inaugural session before her. And she felt bad that she had already planned to go back, so she couldn't stay for this event. So what we're going to do here is just share with you a little bit what we have in mind, because the substance of the program really is going to be developed with the countries and with our agency colleagues that you have seen here. And so we have not cooked anything. So what we're just going to share with you is, this is what we have in mind. What do you guys think? How do we work together? As the CEO mentioned yesterday, create a platform where we can work together, because most of the environment benefits in Africa are in production systems where people are making a living. So we can't ignore the magnitude of that opportunity. It's not all about problems all the time. It's opportunities as well. So that's how we are seeing this. But I'm going to give this talk in three parts. It's very short, but very loaded. The first part is to give you guys GEF 101, because we're not quite used to this crowd, and we don't know how many of you really know. I get a lot of letters and proposals submitted to me. Mohamed, can you please fund this project for me? Well, we're not an easy donor to get money from. So I want to make sure that. Second, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the genesis of the pilot that we are talking about here, and then thirdly, what the next steps will be in order for us to materialize this plan. So, GEF 101, we are a financial mechanism of the Global Environment Conventions, mainly emerging from Rio. So the three that were established during the Rio Summit, the first Rio Summit in 1992, the CBD, the Climate Change Convention, and the Desertification Convention. And we also serve as financial mechanism for the Stockholm Convention, which is mainly focused on persistent organic pollutants, and the newly formed Minamata Convention on Mercury. Okay. So these are the conventions that we finance. Basically, the rich countries give us money, and we administer it to the poor countries so they can meet their obligations under these conventions. So that's just in a nutshell. And the financing we provide is for global environment benefits, which means that we don't 100% finance everything. So the governments have to be doing something that they feel has a lot of environmental implication. Then they come to the GEF and say, please help us address the environment within this framework. And that's how we provide our financing. So we are financed in phases. This is just to give you a snapshot. GEF 1 was our first official phase. There was a pilot before that. And you can see steadily our financing has increased over. We are financed every 4 years. So the next phase, GEF 6, we just got a replenishment of 4.4 billion for 4 years starting this July. And those funds, I'll tell you a little bit how they are programmed. In addition, we also host three other funds in the Secretariat, mainly for climate change, because climate change convention has adaptation and mitigation. Adaptation is considered a local benefit. So they don't fund them out of the trust fund. They are funded through these adaptation funds. So these are not replenished every 4 years. They are replenished on a rolling basis. When the donors have a little bit of change left, they contribute. The Kyoto Protocol Fund is a separate fund that is that was set up by the Secretariat, actually, but we host it in Washington, D.C., but everything is managed out of the Secretariat in Washington. These two funds we actually host in the GEF Secretariat, and we administer them. Our project cycle is very simple. Basically, as I said, we have these 10 agencies, actually 12 agencies now that we've added two. WWF and Conservation International are also now GEF agencies. So countries have to program our resources by working with one of these agencies. We do not give money directly to the countries. But it starts with the countries deciding what is their priority. Then they engage with one of the agencies that they feel is appropriate to their needs. And then the concepts are developed, sent to the Secretariat. We review it. If we like it, we tell them it's okay. And we present, the council approves it. Then it goes back to the agency. Then the agency works with the government to finalize it and get it into implementation. And that's basically how we work. So we do not receive proposals from anybody that we finance except these agencies here. These are the only agencies. So if you want to apply to the GEF, these are the guys you have to talk to, not me. And that's why they're here. Some of them are still here. The funding is allocated into focal areas that are in the GEF instrument. These are the focal areas that the donors, all the countries have agreed are the places where we need to invest in global environment benefits. So biodiversity, land degradation, SFM, Red Plus was just added recently as a mechanism. It's really another focal area. International waters, climate change, and chemicals. So these are the focal areas. This is how we do business, okay? So our CEO, who just joined about a year ago, said, yeah, this is great. We can do business this way. But how are we engaging with governments on the things that matter to them the most? Because these focal areas are more or less silos, if you will, because they speak mainly to the conventions that we finance. How do we get countries to better appreciate that their development priorities are consistent with the mandate that we have for global environment? And so we came up with this idea of integrated approach. And the word pilot there basically is with respect to the GEF. This is something we've never done before. So it is a pilot. The donors want to see, is it going to work? Is it a modality that will actually suit the GEF as a financial mechanism? And so we see the advantage of us being able to work with key drivers, address some of the multi-scale challenges that Bashir has presented, you know, down from the small scale to regional level. You can't segment these problems. Sometimes you got to look across scale. The fact that the GEF is a tiny player in a huge sea of development priorities that countries have. And then, of course, the post-2015 agenda, now that we are in that phase, we want to be able to align our mandate to these big agendas that the countries are now developing. And then synergies and linkages among the focal areas. So the focal areas need to be integrated themselves. So the donors agreed for us to pilot this with three priorities. One is on commodities, basically oil palm, soy, livestock, all these big commodities that are major drivers of environmental change. And this is going to be a global program. Cities, as the CEO said yesterday, urbanization is becoming a huge drain on natural resources. So how do we deal with that? That's also going to be a global program. And then the third one is this food security one, which I will now delve into. So first you might ask, why did we decide on sub-Saharan Africa? Obviously, Africa is not the only place where food security is an issue. But we felt that this is a place where there is a lot of attention at a big enough scale that we can plug in and make ourselves relevant as a financial mechanism for the global environment. Also, there's a lot of money coming through from the countries themselves. Ethiopia, as we heard yesterday, has allocated up to 15% of its budget. That's huge. The CADEP, which is the framework that the governments have agreed to work within, has food security, land and water management as some of the pillars that they are focusing on, in addition to the Environment Initiative Action Plan, which is also under the African Union. And then the evergreen agriculture, you've seen from Bashir, there are lots of really good things happening on this continent, but they are not being scaled up. They're happening at very fragmented scales. And yet, we have seen tremendous potential for scaling up these things if farmers are engaged in the right possible way. And I'm sure Dennis will have something to say about that later on when he wraps up. So we see the potential for bringing ecosystem services into this picture in a big way. And we have decided on food security because of the fact that there are multiple dimensions, but all these dimensions depend on ensuring stability. And that basically brings in the sustainability and the resilience dimension. And so that's why we felt that this will be of interest to a broader community, even if we cannot just engage in a piece of it, maybe on the availability side and on the stability side, not so much on the utilization, which is more nutrition related. But if you look at this diagram from a colleague, Jonathan Foley and his group several years ago, on how ecosystem services are affected in production systems, you don't need to read the text. Just look at the star diagrams. You can see in a system that is natural, most of the ecosystem services are intact. But when you convert that field to agriculture, especially intensive agriculture, you more or less reduce all of the ecosystem services and you maximize the agriculture benefit. This is the reason why agriculture is seen as the enemy to natural resources, but it's actually not the case. Because you can transform these systems, make them more amenable to ecosystem service benefiting. And to the extent that you can increase the ecosystem service benefits back in those systems, even if you don't reach the maximum of what is possible in the natural system. So by focusing there, we believe we can address some of the JEF priorities, especially with respect to biodiversity, climate change, and land degradation. We can deliver these benefits in these systems by just engaging in the right framework. So this is kind of the rationale for us engaging within this area. So what are we going to do? We don't have a detailed results framework yet, but this is what we have in mind. Obviously, we know that in general, productivity increase is the priority. That's what the objectives they are stating. Bashir has already given a picture of what is possible here in Africa in terms of yield and management of natural resources. But the gaps that Bashir highlighted that have relevance for environmental benefits are the areas that we see a lot of potential for engaging. Soil and water conservation, diversification of farms and landscapes, integrated management, so we're not siloing the management of these systems. And then, of course, policies that the governments can put in place to facilitate the scaling up that we're talking about. Multi-stakeholder platform, that's what the CEO mentioned yesterday. We cannot do this. We're a very tiny entity, and so we need to work within the framework of all of the institutional priorities that already exist, including our JEF agency. Many of them are even bigger than the GEF, so they have a lot of role to play in there. The bilateral donors, many of them that give us money in the GEF are also helping countries, the private sector, science organizations. The CGIAR has a huge opportunity that we can tap into to really scale up some of these. And then the regional and sub-regional entities, the African Union and NEPAD agencies. So we see a lot of potential here in addition to the national governments to really bring in these stakeholders together. We're not going to be able to work everywhere, but we have decided that the drylands, especially the Sahel, the Horn of Africa, the Eastern African highlands, and Southern Africa, where the maize is, crop livestock systems are combined with maize production, will be some of the places where we can see potential for transformation. So those are the places that we're going to focus. The countries will have to decide whether they want to do this or not. And how are we going to get them to engage? Well, the GEF allocates money to countries. They are indicative allocations. We don't write them a check, but we tell them this is how much you have available to you if you are able to program it within 4 years. So each country has an allocation that's calculated through a complex formula that I'm not going to go into. Anyway, so the 120 million that the CEO announced yesterday includes 60 million from those country allocations. So the countries will have to decide that they want to be part of this program by showing how much of their allocation they will commit. And then we will match it from a separate incentive pot that we have created. The modalities for this is still being worked out, but this is how we're going to fund the program. So if you want to participate, those of you who are here from your countries, this is the good time to engage the JEF operational focal points to get more information about how we can get your country involved. So this is my last slide. We had a conceptual phase. Basically, this was important. We had to convince the donors, so we spent a lot of time. Almost this phase lasted a year, just to convince the donors that this is a good thing to do. So they finally agreed. So now we're moving to this program design phase. We have to understand what these target geographies really have, what are the opportunities there. We have to develop a results framework with targets, outcomes, indicators, and agree together with all of the countries and the agencies how we're going to track these and how we're going to deliver them. And then the agencies will work with the countries to design the individual projects for each country, as well as the cross-cutting agenda that we have to address. So this is basically how we're going to get to designing the program. Dennis, that's my last slide. Thank you very much again. Great. Sorry, this was a bit of a rapid fire.
Thank you.